Good afternoon. My name is Peter Jungen. I have the pleasure to be invited to chair this next session with two gentlemen I'd like to call, and it's an honor to call them my friends, Edmond Alphandery and Ian Goldin. There's nothing I have to say about them. You know everything. In the last 2 weeks, there was a poll taken in Germany on whether or not the world is better off today than ever in history, whether poverty in the world increases, whether, of course, inequality in the world is increasing, and so on. Almost 99% of the people responded yes. So saying poverty in the world is increasing. We are all worse off than we were before. The future is bleak, and so on. And it's amazing to see how difficult it is to get all these messages across, even in the United States, obviously. And I see also that Jagdish Bhagwati is with us. He said in his book that Marx was famously wrong when he predicted the progressive immiseration of the proletariat, and he gave globalization, as he called it, a human face. If it has a human face, I think hundreds of millions of people who are expressing this. Now, in this country, there is a debate, and I'm not going into that, but it's on labor force participation, on business and labor dynamism, and investment is down, productivity growth is down, and so on. This is a very US view, of course, and if you look on the worldwide basis, we may come to other conclusions, and I'm sure you will learn more about this today. When people say maybe investment is down, maybe it's down because less investment is needed because of innovation and because of the new technologies, and what better could be in for the world if the world needs less investments in CapEx, less minerals, less energy, and whatever. So there may be a lot of different reasons for that. But to remember that maybe the good old days are here today. And there were no good old days in the world before at any given point in time. In the 16th and 17th century in Florence, you had a famine about every 5 years, even there. And the world was growing for thousands of years with a 0.06%. As a result, GDP per capita of the population of the world around 1800, was about the same as 10,000 before Christ. So the world may be in a better shape than ever before, but maybe we will learn more about in the further discussion and the contributions. We are seeing a lot of publications coming up these days. We say that Gordon, that the innovation has been eating up. We see Brynjolfsson and McGaffey saying there's more going on in the world than ever before. I'll leave it to you which one you're going to choose. But let me say something. We are suffering just now from a bat attack of economic pessimism. And it's common to hear people say that the epoch of enormous progress is over, and that the rapid improvement in the standard of life is going to slow down, and that the decline in prosperity is more likely than an improvement in the decade which lies ahead of us. We are suffering from the growing pains of over-rapid changes, from the painfulness of readjustments between one economic period and another, and the increase of technical efficiency has been taking place faster than we can deal with the problem of labor absorption and employment. And the standard of life has been a little too rising a little bit too quick. Now, most of you know by that time that this is not myself saying that. That's the quote from John Maynard Keynes in 1930 when he published this in a book which was on a piece already mentioned once today on the economic possibilities for our grandchildren. But the amazing thing is that it looks very familiar to what we see in Benjamin Franklin more than 240 years ago, 36 years ago, said the progress of human knowledge will be rapid and discoveries made of which we have present and no conception. I begin to almost to be sorry I was born so soon, since I cannot have the happiness of knowing what will be known 100 years hence. I think if you look at this and you look at the development of the world until now in terms of food and sanitation and life expectancy and poverty and environment, literacy, freedom, equality, we really have to ask ourselves, are there reasons for hope? And the interesting thing is the title of this session didn't have a question mark. It just said reasons for hope. And I hope we are able to fulfill the expectations that one or the others may have. And it's interesting to see in the book of Brynjolfsson and McGaffey, there is a nice graph where they say the world over millions of years, and then was the end of the Neanderthal about 30,000 years ago. And then still, it's all very flat until about 240, 50 years ago. And the quote I like very much is say, life after the Neanderthal has been pretty boring for those who survived. And that is the human genes and we. One good thing is that all the predictions of the Club of Rome have one thing in common. They were all wrong. And I think we should be very careful in making this kind of long-term prediction unqualified, and that should give us a case. Now, this is only a few remarks as an introduction, but let me add one more observation. In this debate about innovation drying up or not, there are very early indicators showing that this may not be the case. This is something which is familiar to two or three people in this room, but not most of them. And this is angel investing, business angel investing, and venture capital has been higher in 2015 on the world level than in one, except one year, 2000, but it has been higher ever before, and it's spread all over the world. The good news is the U.S. is still leading in terms of volume, not in terms of investment per capita. This, of course, is Israel. But if you compare the U.S. and Israel, you see about $250 per head in the U.S., 300 in Israel. The Eurozone is about $8 to $10 compared to the U.S., the EU maybe 15 to 20. China is already higher than the Eurozone in venture capital investment per capita of the population. So maybe there is not much going on in the same stuff in the Western world, and definitely not in Europe, as people would like, but is going on in the world. And maybe we'll learn today in the contribution of my two colleagues that there is more going on the world basis, which is affecting the life of billions of people, and not only of a few hundred millions of people, of which we are usually concentrating our view. Having said that, I would like Ian Goldin to give his presentation right away, if you like, from here, and then immediately afterwards followed by Edmond Alphandery as a discussant. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thanks very much, Peter. It's a huge pleasure and privilege to be here. and to very briefly share some hopeful thoughts. I also will give you some pretty images rather than difficult graphics to analyze to make you even more hopeful that the end of a very depressing series of lectures is here. This is the reason to be hopeful. Walls are coming down everywhere. Ideas are traveling more rapidly, more places, and in more dimensions than ever in history. And if you believe in the power of ideas for change, that's the era we live in. For many of us, our lives. It's changed everything. It changed my life dramatically. I was at the OECD in Paris. I thought I would never go back to South Africa in my lifetime. And within 4 months of the wall coming down, Mandela was released. A year later, he came to Paris and he asked me to be his economic advisor. 65 countries became democratic within 4 years, and the world changed in fundamental ways, with dictatorships which had existed for decades being overturned everywhere. And because ideas traveled, more people lived longer, healthier lives, infant mortality collapsed, and life expectancy increased, and we have 2 billion more people in the world. If you can't be hopeful, then one needs to look at the numbers. The number of literate, educated people soared. We went from a world of barely a billion educated people, only 2 billion literate people in the 1980s, to a world of 5.6 billion literate people and over 3 billion highly educated people with secondary educations within a period of 30 years. Another reason I believe to be hopeful. Those that believe that innovation is slowing down must somehow believe that the new literate have less brain power than us old literate. If you believe in the random distribution of exceptional talent, there's just a lot more talented people out there. But they won't emerge necessarily from the streets of New York or Oxford. They'll come from Mumbai, Shanghai, Sao Paulo, and elsewhere, the new breakthrough people. But it's not individuals that change the world only, it's teams, it's collectives, it's people working in the cloud, finding new cures for cancer on 24-hour research cycles. It's people learning to do new things in new ways at quantums of significant difference to anything imaginable before. And you can see that on any dimension you look at, patent applications, journal articles, or whatever particular metric you want to look at. So we should be immensely hopeful that there are more people thinking about problem solving in the world than ever in history, and they're connected, and that they will have that capability. And of course, they are not only virtually connected, increasingly physically too, because 80% of the world now in a major city or less than an hour away from a major city. There are lots of ways of talking about this period we live in as being different and fundamentally more connected. And because we're interested in financial flows, let's look at these. The simple point of this graphic is that they were relatively stable and flat till about 1990, much higher orders of magnitude and much more instability since then. The top flow is foreign direct investments, the green flow is remittances, what migrant workers send back, the black flow is portfolio, bond and equity flows, and the bottom flow is official flows. And so when you look at this period in the long sweep of history, it's not surprising that you get this most extraordinary story. The right-hand axis exponential, left-hand arithmetic, green is population growth, red is income growth, and we see income growth exceeding population growth, although both have never been close to this rapidity. There was a period about 1,000 years ago when income growth exceeded population growth. That period, like our period, a period of integration and globalization, when Asia and Europe met each other and ideas that had been developed over millennia were swapped. And you had this accelerating change. It didn't last. The Renaissance, which I'll talk about, made no difference to the world in this respect. But our time is different. And this discussion is entirely about what's next. Can we imagine that this is sustained, or is this aberration in history something we will remember as just a short experience? Now, the reason we need to celebrate and the reason we need to be hopeful is because never has so much been achieved so quickly by humanity, by a very, very large margin. Average life expectancy increasing in the world by about 20 years over this period. Just while we're here together for about 10 hours, our average life expectancy will improve by about 200 minutes. That's the pace of progress. It is absolutely phenomenal, and it's because of what's happening in the labs as well as what we're learning around the world. Smoking kills you, things like that. Illiteracy collapsing from about 2 3 billion illiterate people in the 1980s to less than 1 billion illiterate people today in a world where population has increased by 2.3 billion and the number of desperately poor people going down by 300 million, even though the population increased by 2 billion. This has never happened in history. And if you want to sleep happily tonight, remember this is by far the best time to be alive, not only for us, but for most people in most places. Of course, Angus Deaton and others have pointed to groups of people like the workers in the Midwest that he talks about, whose life expectancy is lower than their parents, but they are the exceptions, together with the people of Southern Africa and Russia, who for very different reasons have suffered from HIV/AIDS or events in Russia. But these are global exceptions. The trends are overwhelmingly positive. The question is, what is going to happen next? And I've tried to learn in my new book, Age of Discovery, from the only comparable period, I believe, in terms of tumultuous change, and that is the Renaissance. People talk about this as the fourth industrial revolution. I know someone's writing a book calling it the fifth industrial revolution, but I think that is to trivialize what's going on here. This is not simply a process or business revolution. This is something which is affecting all dimensions of humanity, perspective, and all others. And I think the Renaissance is the most helpful guide for that reason. We celebrate it 500 years later because in a period of 80 years, it took Europe from being one of the most backward places on Earth to by far the most advanced. And it was driven by a change in perspectives, of course, change in science, which led the world to become round, Mercator's projection. Scientific discoveries like the one that we went around the sun, not around us, driven by a technological platform, then the Gutenberg press, completely revolutionizing the way that ideas traveled. Before that, only monks could read and write, and scribes, Latin, small number of very expensive manuscripts, and suddenly ideas were democratized. And ordinary people in their own language could learn, and they learned quickly, and you had the Renaissance, and you also had very high levels of migration. Florence, 30-40% of people from outside Italy coming to it at the peak of its creativity. Similar with Amsterdam and other great inventive cities. Unfortunately, not only good things traveled. Terrible things connected to syphilis, diseases that, of course, ended up killing most Native Americans, and jihadism, extremism. Savonarola deposing the Medicis in Florence in the most extraordinary revolution, using the new technologies, inventing the political pamphlet, which was the 1490s equivalent of Donald Trump's tweeting, ending in the bonfire of the vanities, which we know about, the burning of books, the challenging of the corruption of the church, which allowed you to buy your way to heaven with indulgences, the pushback with the inquisitions, the protectionism, and the hounding out of intellectuals and experts. Is our time different? Does tumultuous change necessarily lead to extremism, and what was going on then, which we can learn from like now? Well, then like now, while many people benefited enormously, the walls went down between societies. Within them, they started going up. The gold was brought back from the New World, put on the domes of cathedrals. People walked the streets of Florence in silk and they enjoyed their spices, but most people continued to eat gruel and the scribes were put out of work. It did not lead to a generalized improvement in the standards of living of Florentines or others. And of course, we see in this period of more rapid change that people are being left behind faster. This is relative, not absolute deprivation. And it's about perceptions of fairness. We don't care, well, I care, but most people don't care, if a football star, American or British, or pop star earns hundreds of millions of dollars. But we do care if it's a CEO. So perceptions become more significant in periods of rising inequality. And there's no doubt, and the data on trade, which Jagdish and many others have been at the heart of, shows that the returns to skill and the returns to being flexible are greater in periods of more integration and openness. So flexibility and investments in flexibility in housing markets, in transport systems, in labor markets becomes more and more important as the churn gets more rapid. The second great lesson of this time is that of the butterfly defect. The transferring across this integrated system of the bads as well as the goods of globalization. I'm going to come back to that. I want to race through some of these trends that have occurred as a result of it. The first I've already touched on, which is this rapid rising life expectancy and convergence. The other one, which is less appreciated, is the collapse of fertility around the world. Over half the countries in the world below replacement level. And I'm drawing here on the work of the Oxford Martin School, which brings together over 500 academics across Oxford, including many demographers and others. So the whole world except Africa converging way below replacement level over the next 20 years, and with that the stabilization of all population areas except African and the population of the world stabilizing. But median age is doubling in the process. And so part of what we're seeing here is a rapid restructuring of societies in which our old assumptions of population pyramids need to be replaced by new understandings of the structure of society with many implications, not least for jobs and for careers, pensions and retirement. When the packages were built in the 1960s, average life expectancy was 7 years on retirement and real risk adjusted returns were 4%. Now, average life expectancy is already 25 years and real risk adjusted returns are 0.5%. So one has to save 100 times more already for an equivalent standard of living in one's retirement. Where's the money going to come from? Consumption. Where's it going to go to? Real estate's obviously going to do well, but what other sectors? And the many other particularly important and significant dimensions of this, including the increasing gender differences, because women are wiser than men and don't die as soon from making stupid decisions like smoking and drinking and others. But this is across the world, this sort of pattern. This was built for the US before the Trump victory and shows the importance of immigration, because over half the children being born in the US today are born to first and second generation immigrant parents. And this is the structure one wants going forward, but of course it's gravely threatened by Trump's victory. So demographics is one very important part of this rapid change and is going to increasingly affect many things, including, of course, the politics. On the economic prospects, my view is that the discussion we've been having today is profoundly biased by an Anglo-Saxon perspective. The world has never been doing better ever in history than it's doing today. Growth rates are more rapid on average than they've been on any historical period, and the added value to the global economy today is greater than any past day in history. If one can't make money as a business person, it's not because it's not there to be made, it's because you just happen to be in the wrong place where it is being made. This is a very significant global rebalancing. Emerging markets growing on average by 3 times the rate of the old advanced economies, and in that process, size matters. If you read the FT, you'd think that China's in crisis growing at 6%, but 6% growth on a $17 trillion economy is much more rapid than 10% growth on an $8 trillion economy 12 years ago in terms of the value added every day. And of course, it can't keep growing at 10%+. It'll be the whole world economy before long if it carried on at that rate. So it's inevitable it slows down, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the world growth will slow down, because the composition of developing countries is changing and because their share of global growth is becoming more significant. So average global growth rates will actually increase even though the advanced economy growth rates remain tepid in the foreseen future. And they will also, I believe, average global growth rates become more stable because there'll be more global growth engines. So when the US gets a cold, the world will no longer get fever. Obviously, we'll feel it when China gets a cold. So stabilization and higher average global growth rates. The conversations that are happening today I think, are very biased by the US experience and Europe's. Because if you ask China and India increasingly now, and Jagdish was at the forefront of conversations when India was going through its very anti-globalization phase, these countries have never been more pro-globalist because they know they are benefiting so strongly from it. With this sort of thing, you begin to get convergence of many countries with the levels of per capita incomes of the advanced economies over the foreseeable future, with many countries reaching the per capita levels of the UK in the foreseeable future. Obviously, per capita income depends not only on growth rates, but population rates. And because China's population has stopped growing and it has 1.6 million less workers this year than last, all income growth converts into per capita. And so it goes up to $30,000 very quickly, whereas India, with population growth rates at over 2.7 and Africa with around 2.9, are going to take much longer. But the global shares of growth are changing in distribution, and of course the explosion of where the middle class is. This middle class we worry so much about is less and less a US or European middle class. It's a global middle class that's broadly very happy. So our concerns are obviously related to what's happening here. The shares of global consumption also changing dramatically over this period of time, and the US becoming a smaller and smaller part of the story. And one of the many, many reasons why Brexit was a stupid idea was because actually Europe will be double the size of the US market in the years to come. Can it happen? Is there enough resource? I'm going to race back to that. I want to just touch briefly with some of the concerns, not least those that were raised by David Rose so shortly. Now, all predictions about the future are wrong, except by accident if you happen to be right. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't think about it and worry about it more. Of course we should, because everything we care about is about that. One thing I would very much agree with David on is this exponential growth in computing power, which is Moore's law, and I have over 40 people working on this in the Oxford Martin School, including a quantum computing group, and they think this is stable for at least the next 20 years. But what I would not agree on at all is Ray Kurzweil or Peter Diamandis' conclusions in abundance and the singularity is near, although one of my colleagues, Nick Bostrom, has sort of nurtured that debate, because these are institution and politics-free books which do not feature. There's no problem that an app cannot solve, and that's, of course, not how the world will reproduce itself, because people will stop technologies and they will shape them in their own ways. One of the incredible things we're able to do now, of course, is build at the nano level. This is from my nanomedicine lab in the Oxford Martin School, trying to find new cures for cancer. This is the lab technician's skin turned into a heart cell. This is what genetic modification can do. The back mouse, a wild mouse, the front one, a slightly genetically modified mouse. The back mouse drops out after about 200 meters, 20 minutes. The front one goes for 2 hours, 2 kilometers, same mice. Very happy, especially the front one. But this raises many, many, many questions of a social and political dimension, as of course does gene editing in terms of whether we're going to be creating superhumans or using gene editing to overcome differences. Now, another thing that is not appreciated, I think, by Ray or Peter Diamandis is that all technologies are dual use. This is, of course, something that Einstein and many others have worried a great deal about. DNA sequencing coming down exponentially, that's wonderful. A friend of mine is developing a DNA sequencer that'll cost $100 and take 10 minutes to do the human genome. This was what took Craig Venter $3 billion and 10 years in the 1980s. That's wonderful. All of our healthcare will be improved. But a crazy person with the same technologies can build smallpox or measles and get a drone and fly it down our streets or Wall Streets or stadium and kill us all with it. And so these technologies are immense source for progress, but also could kill us in numerous new ways. And that's not only true with pathogens, it's of course true in every dimension. Baring's bank had existed for over 200 years, withstanding the most extraordinary political technological changes. Its management were brilliant, until one day they woke up and discovered that one of their kids had destroyed them. Using a bit of leverage, Nick Leeson had managed to destroy this bank that had existed for 200 years. And we've seen almost the same thing happening with JP Morgan, Societe Generale, UBS, and all the other banks. So these weapons of mass destruction, as Warren Buffett would call them, have both an immensely positive and immensely negative challenge to us. And as we think about the space of change, understanding complexity and risk becomes more and more significant. The long tail of uncertain impacts, because if we want to be hopeful for the future, we've got to be hopeful because we understand the downside risks as well as the extraordinary, unprecedented upside benefits. And it's that downside of globalization which needs much more careful management, not least the externalities that come from hyperconnectivity and accelerating technological change, be they social, like inequality, or other like pathogens. Now, the idea of cascading risk is not new. We think in the UK that a rat coming off a ship might have killed half the British population with an early episode of globalization. What's new is the butterfly defect. The pace and scale and cascading over silos, that is different. So the next financial crisis, I believe, is as likely to come from a pandemic or a Hurricane Sandy or a 9/11 that's a bit differently dimensioned as it is from the collapse of a big bank, which is what most people seem to be worried about. We are not just connected, we are entangled. Connectivity implies that somehow we can disconnect. That, of course, is not what's going on. There is no way you can disconnect from entangled systems, and that's one of the many, many reasons why Trump is so desperately misguided. So the swine flu that starts in Mexico cities in 160 countries in 25 days, and the emerging infections group in the Oxford Martin School shows that this exactly replicates airline traffic. The super spreaders of the goods of globalization are the super spreaders of the bads as well. So how does one manage this underbelly, not least in the cyber world, which is the nervous system? And how does one deal with the issue that David Rose put on the table, which is that they're going to take our jobs? The work in the Oxford Martin School by Frey and Osborne suggests that 47, not 70, but 47% of US jobs are vulnerable to machine intelligence. But the point that's been made is absolutely right, that there'll be new jobs and different jobs, and society can stop this. Germany has banned GMOs and nuclear power. It's not because technologies exist that means that we embrace them. It's because we work out how we move to touch them and then use them to enhance our well-being. I just want to end with a series of reflections, because I've got 4 minutes left, on externalities. Now, these are obviously something that economists have thought about very deeply and broadly for a very long time. We know the tragedy of the commons. It's what we're meant to be good at thinking about. This is the tuna market in Tokyo. This tuna was sold for $1.5 million. This is the market's response to the scarcity of an inelastic good. And of course, we see that with more and more natural resources. High-tech fishermen will chase out the remaining tuna. The problem is that we know that governments are very poor at allocating scarce resources too, because they are short-term and because they're driven by national, not collective, interests. And clearly with climate change, we have the most challenging of these on multiple dimensions. The science is absolutely clear about this. It's 19th century physics. And without any radical changes to the way our energy systems work, we are on the way to well over 2 degrees. Of course, the political economy is complicated by the fact that the advanced economies have created the stock, but the flow increasingly is going to be a flow from emerging markets. So how one gets this resolved is, of course, going to require dramatic action. The system that exists is totally unfit for 21st century purpose, where the changes are cosmetic and small, and where we go about our business like individual countries within cabins with no captain on the deck. Many of the reasons for this are good reasons. We can't imagine the world led by 12 white men smoking cigars anymore. That's good news, and it's good news that the emerging markets have grown and that the old advanced economies no longer believe they can run the world. But in this process, we have a power transition, which is extremely dangerous. So the system is hyper-globalized, but the politics remains 30, 50 years behind this process. And it's that which is the greatest challenge, is who's going to manage the risk. Now, finance is by far the most sophisticated of the global management systems. Our central banks, our treasuries, our Fed reserves, our IMFs at the global level are a league on their own compared to all other government departments or international institutions. And that's what makes the financial crisis so profoundly disturbing. These are not stupid people. These people have intense data capacity. They are hyper joined up. They play golf together at Jackson Hole once a year. And yet, despite their very clear mission, which is financial stability, they were unable to see the crisis coming or do anything about it. So this is what makes me worried. This is by far the best of our global systems. Forget the UN. Think IMF. Think Fed. SEC. What did they not see? They didn't understand the structural shifts, hyper-interdependence and complexity. They didn't understand the nodes and networks and how these become critical points of vulnerability. A back-of-the-envelope calculation could have told them that when you pulled the plug on Lehman, you would destroy the financial system. They didn't do something that a junior graduate student could have done easily, although there were 200,000 of them with PhDs. It wasn't a failure of capacity, it was a failure of perception. The governance was national, not connected. The system was hyper-connected. The technologies were not understood by the old men like me running the system. They were run by young kids. I did physics and maths 30 years ago, but I can't outsmart my best graduates today who are doing regulatory arbitrage with these same technologies. The accounting systems of mark-to-market accounting standards drove short-termism, as did the incentive. So there was no incentive in the politics or in the banking system to try and resolve longer-term brooding problems. And this is partly because of the ubiquitous globalization of MBAs and lean management and just-in-time. This is the citations of lean management literature and how they went global with the globalization of other dimensions of ideas. And finally, the problem was not too little data, but too much data, being blinded by the blizzard of it and unable to use judgment and wisdom. Unable to understand and think, even when everyone knew that there was clearly a bubble. So what comes out of this is two perceptions. The one is that the leaders of our societies are unable to manage rapid change, and those people being left behind are being left behind more quickly. And the second is that we're unable to manage systemic risk. So the goods of globalization, risk being overwhelmed by the bads. And what we've seen in the pushback on the Arab Spring in Egypt and Syria and elsewhere is part of that pushback, but it's much deeper than that. Of course, it's in the trade dimensions, it's in Brexit, and it's in Trump. So the responsibility of those, and I would certainly count myself as being amongst them, that believe that globalization and connectivity bring the best potential that humanity's ever had to resolve its problems are greater than ever. The onus is on us to work out how we can keep this integrated system together and not let it fall apart, and draw on all the wisdom we can in that. And to that end, I want to celebrate Ned and his calling of this conference, because I think it is a very significant part of that process, will allow people to solve the problems so we can rock on to a very happy old age. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Ian. You rightly mentioned that not only for inviting to the conference, but to two-thirds of your books, you have demonstrated what he published in Mass Flourishing, that there's the eagerness of the world to create and explore and to meet challenges. And with the latter one, you finish, and I now hand it over to Edmond Alphandery for this contribution.
Okay, many thanks first to Ned for inviting me to this fascinating conference. I learned a lot by reading Age of Recovery. Discovery of Jan Goldin and Chris Kotana, to which I have been asked to react. In order to better understand the time in which we are living, they take as a reference period Europe's Renaissance. This is certainly a good choice, even though, and the author acknowledges it, other periods in other parts of the world could have shed light as well. Selecting a period is always subjective and depends on what you expect from the comparison. Each period in history is by definition unique, and this present time, at least for the subject of this conference, innovation and flourishing, could find some roots in the 20th century. The question which deserves to be addressed in this perspective of our debate is, in my view, the following. How the globalization process, defined as the rapid development of market economy globally, interacting with the spread of innovations, impact our lives and life on Earth. Markets foster the spread of innovations, and the spread of innovations foster markets. The characteristic of globalization of our present time is that it brings with it a rising amount of externalities. You put emphasis on that, which are hardly quantifiable, often for the global at the global level, many of them for the good, some for the bad. Look at the innovations which use is rapidly expanding, deeply affecting their life worldwide. Laptops, iPads, smartphones, internets, robots. One part of their impact is internalized in prices, but there are very important positive externalities which are not. More facility to exchange, to learn, better quality of life, more information, and so on. Other externalities are negative. The pace of diffusion of this innovation, coupled with the globalization process, may entail huge social costs. Those who are losing their job may need time to acquire the qualification necessary to find new positions when they are not condemned to exit the labor market. This problem is not new. It dates back to the birth of capitalism. And Schumpeter, with its theory of creative destruction, has explained the dynamic process by which the capitalist system adapts itself to innovation, at least in the long run. But what is nowadays is new is the simultaneous rising pace of the diffusion of innovation and of market globalization. And this adaptation is socially more painful and may have political impacts. Just look at what happened in the UK with Brexit and this country with Donald Trump's election. The inability of the Rawlsian type of social models based on individual contracts to cope by themselves with externalities could be analyzed in the spirit of the famous book of John Hicks, A Theory of Economic History, as leading to political institutions to emerge in some kind of endogenous process to foster positive externalities like education, trade, and fight the negative ones like social risk or dangers. The main issue today lies not so much on how to cope with positive externalities, even though it may give rise to rising inequalities, but on the treatment of global negative externalities. In the introduction of your book, Mr. Goldin, you point out that, I quote you, carbon pollution has pushed atmospheric greenhouse gases today to concentration not seen since Neolithic days. 14 of the 15 hottest years in our climate record have all come in the 21st century. This is the most serious challenge since global warming puts life on Earth in jeopardy. Will the dual trend of accelerating globalization and spread of innovation allows us to successfully overcome this threat. Innovation is the production, in the production of clean energy is certainly progressing fast. But the market economy doesn't know how to integrate correctly these negative externalities. Shall we have to forbid the activities which are a source of carbon emission? Not realistic. Could we succeed to put a significant price on carbon worldwide? But we don't have the global governance to impose it. With the COP21 Paris Agreement, we certainly have made a step in the right direction. But for the time being, there is still a huge gap to fill before we can say that we have mastered this immense scourge. As the many other scourges coming from negative externalities, dearth of drinkable water, disappearance of species, which the market economy is important to face. These huge global challenges are what makes the century, this century, this 21st century, totally unique. They call for the development of intellectual and political approach which are still in their infancy. But this observation, which goes much beyond the object of this excellent book, should not prevent you and those who have not read it to plunge into it. Looking back to Europe's Renaissance, they will discover a lot about the fascinating world in which we are living.
Well, thank you very much, Edmond, for your comments to the book. I don't dare to ask the organizer whether we can take questions, but I think we're running behind schedule. We have not contributed very much more than we started later, but I think you all agree that this has, both contributions have shown there are reasons to believe that there is room for hope. And there was a piece in the Handelsblatt 3 days ago. They didn't know about the conference, and the headline was, "There are reasons for hope." And one more notion. I think particularly the contribution showing us that maybe we have less economic problems, we have a political problem, a governance, and maybe we don't need artificial intelligence, but rather extended intelligence, what I would actually prefer to say that. And with that, unfortunately, I have to close the session and thank both contributors again very much.
Only this panel stands between you and the bar. We have a very distinguished panel to close this out. We had to, we couldn't find anyone in the Northeast who would be willing to talk about agency when it comes to moral choices. So we kept going west until we finally got to Minnesota and found Dean Robert Vischer at the St. Cloud Law School. So thank you for coming all the way out here. We have this incredible phenomenon of 2016. J.D. Vance, whose book, if you haven't read it, it's actually no longer available because it's sold out so many times, but Hillbilly, Elegy is really an extraordinary portrait of a part of America that we don't read about in the New York Times. It's an extremely powerful book, and the fact that it's written by someone who went to law school is really almost inconceivable to me. I think the honor of being the only lawyer who'd written a best-selling book before. Now he's leaps ahead of me. I'm very pleased to have him here. I met him once, actually, when he was in law school. But I'm very pleased to have him here because that makes two rednecks in the audience today, because I grew up in Eastern Kentucky, so he and I could talk in dialect later if you get too obstreperous. Our third panelist is Richard Robb. I asked Richard what he was going to say, and he said he had no idea. He is he's a member here of the Center on Capitalism and Society. He's very smart, so I'm sure that he won't embarrass himself too much.
Thanks, Philip.
Yeah, you're welcome. The title of this panel is actually sort of not in English, Regaining Agency and Other Values. Agency is actually ownership from which hopefully you can assert your values, but it's not, you know, they're two different concepts, I think, but you get the drift of it. As I said in my opening remarks this morning, I think regaining human agency is not an idea, it's not a preference, it's not a way of improving things a little bit. It's the idea, I think, requires a basic shift in philosophy. For 100 years, starting with the later phases of the Industrial Revolution, we had to figure out how we were going to create joint enterprises. And we started, the great innovation was Taylorism that Simon Head and others talked about, which was telling people exactly how to do things, controlling them. And it kind of worked. It also drove people crazy. But it did work. It gave us assembly lines and the like. 50 years ago, we started doing that with regulation. We woke up to bad values, racism, pollution, sexism, mistreatment of the disabled, and we changed our regulatory philosophy to make it be Tayloristic. We would tell people exactly how to do things properly. And so for 50 years, we've been piling this regulatory accretion as problems emerge, and of course, the regulation never works because it's central planning. They have to write new rules to elaborate on how the old rules are supposed to work, and so now we're sort of clogged up. These problems, the problem of organizing joint enterprises like companies, the problems of oversight by government, cannot be wished away. They are necessary problems of a joint, as Ian Goldin was saying, unbelievably interdependent, interconnected, inextricably interdependent society. The air we breathe, the water we drink, we put our loved ones into places in the care of people we don't know. Our freedom depends on all sorts of levels of government oversight. And the success of business similarly depends on oversight, creating standards for the hotels that somebody was talking about earlier, and such. So we can't wish them away. But what's happened is initially, although we've gotten away from it somewhat in business, but certainly in government, we tried to create automatic systems to make these things work without human intervention. And it doesn't work. And for lots of reasons, people, and I won't give my talk again from this morning. And so what's needed, I think, to regain agency and the ownership of your own values is not just a shift in degree. We should sort of let people do a little more. What's needed is an inversion. We need to not do away with regulation and not dream of a libertarian utopia, which will never happen. But we have to actually start evaluating what humans are able to do. How much time does the doctor have to actually think about and care for the patients and the teacher and the nurse and everyone? How much freedom does a person have in the workplace? Simon Head has written a lot about quality of work. There's a young professor who's Turkish at MIT I was on a panel on recently called Zeynep Ton, who's talked about how you create ownership of your choices and jobs, even in fairly repetitive settings. How do people get back a sense that they own their choices and they have the dignity and the satisfaction of actually making a difference? So we need that in government, we need it in companies, we need it in community, instead of top-down things, the Robert Putnam problem. We need it for innovation, Ned Phelps's great sort of work around flourishing and such. People need to be free to do that. You can't constrain them and have it begin to work. So what we need to understand is that powerlessness corrupts. It's profound. It really, we've created this system. We just had an election that I think to a great extent is a result of that. Humans need to own their choices. So we're going to have the panel, very different perspectives, I think. Before we do, I'm going to show a 2.5-minute video. Bill Bradley, Mitch Daniels, and I, in August, started a social media campaign called Who's in Charge Around Here. We've hired a writer from The Daily Show, and it's all about advocating a more human system of government, where laws and regulations are much simpler, people can make choices. Here's a video we have actually not put up yet. Our first one was called, no, that's not the one I want, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
I want, first one was called, Put Humans in Charge. And the second one, I need to put simpler. Is it simpler?
Yeah.
It's called Why Bureaucracy is Evil.
Most people know bureaucracy is annoying, but actually, it's evil. Bureaucracy is evil because it prevents people from using their minds like some kind of alien virus. It takes over our brain and turns people into robots. Rules and forms seem so harmless. Just make sure you're doing things properly. Oh, and make sure you can prove you did it too. But detailed rules use up our brain power. Filling out forms requires you to focus on each line. Thinking about dozens of rules means you're not thinking about doing your job. Pretty soon you find yourself filling out forms that nobody reads, worrying about violating rules you don't even know. Bureaucracy either drives people crazy because it keeps them from doing their job sensibly, or it transforms them into robots themselves. The number one reason good teachers quit is frustration over needless bureaucracy. Doctors too. Bureaucracy tangles up almost everyone, everywhere. Here's the disconnect. Bureaucrats seem to think that people are like computers, that we can be programmed with 1,000 rules. Truth is, humans are really good at solving problems, but most problem solving occurs in our subconscious. Rules and forms can't be internalized down there. Humans can't remember or manage countless complex rules. Trying to keep them straight uses up too much of our brain powers and slams the door on our ability to use common sense. The force is no longer with us. We become bad computers, like early generation robots who keep doing the wrong thing at the wrong time. Trying to make things better, bureaucracy makes things fail. The effects can be tragic. The nurse's aide calls 911 instead of reviving the person. The teacher worried about proving misbehavior can't maintain order in the classroom. The solution is simple, literally. Make everything simpler so we can use our heads and focus on what's important. Rules are needed, but should focus on goals like speed limits or making sure the restaurant you're eating at tonight is clean. Detailed rules and checklists should be reserved to things that are really complicated, like pollution limits. Simpler rules would allow us all, regulators and regulated alike, to pursue public goals without drowning in detail. It would allow disagreements to focus on what's right and sensible. It would allow us to use our heads. After all, law can't think. Mindless bureaucracy doesn't support freedom. It suffocates freedom. Red tape is not the price of good government. It's the enemy of good government. It's time to reboot government. Bulldoze bureaucracy and create a simple framework that people can understand. Share this video and then go to simplifygov.org to learn more. Let's put humans in charge again.
Okay, Rob?
Sure. Thanks. Thanks. It's great to be invited to participate. I also am a lawyer, I'm the author of a couple of books, both of which have been read, not in their entirety, but mostly by my mother. So it's not quite at the same level. What I want to talk about today is actually to start with a quote from J.D.'s book, Hillbilly, Elegy, because it frames my topic nicely, and I promise I'm not going to give your talk on your behalf. But in a portion of Hillbilly Elegy, he talks about being asked if he could change something for the white working class, what would it be? And he says, the feeling that our choices don't matter. Okay? And as Philip and others have talked about, this past election was less about policy and more about a feeling of powerlessness. And so I want to talk a little bit about what that looks like in the area of moral choices, moral deliberation, moral commitments. To what extent can moral agency be a reality, and is that driving some of this sense of powerlessness? So over the past 50 years, we've frequently equated our commitment to solving a social problem with our willingness to move responsibility for the solution to the federal government, and we've built programs that can take on lives of their own and extend into contexts and create incentives that were never intended. Whether we're talking about anti-poverty initiatives, the war on drugs, the move toward uniform criminal sentencing, whether or not any one of those areas should have been addressed primarily at the local level, I don't think it's too controversial to note that the broader trend toward federalization, toward programmatic solutions that extend over many years, generations, have had some negative consequences for the cultivation of human agency among the working class. So here's the question I'd like us to reflect on for just a few minutes. Should caution about top-down, one-size-fits-all legal solutions to practical problems also apply to our assessment of top-down, one-size-fits-all legal resolutions of moral disputes? That is, if we care about human agency, how do we discern the moral norms that should govern our public lives, and at what point should we invest those norms with legal authority? This past election had some of these themes driving as an undercurrent, right? If you take the swing state of North Carolina, there was certainly some economic concern driving voter behaviors, but if you look at the tone and the tenor and the substance of the conversation, some of it was about restrooms, right? So the Obama administration issuing the rule where public schools could lose their federal funding if they didn't allow students to use the restroom of their gender identity as opposed to the gender listed on their birth certificate. It was followed up then with the NCAA taking basketball tournaments away from North Carolina. The NBA took the All-Star game. The Atlantic Coast Conference took a basketball tournament away from North Carolina. North Carolinians, if you didn't know that, care a lot about basketball, right? So it was their reaction, is the hostility for many North Carolinians, especially outside the university settings in that state, was that primarily about bias against the transgendered? Maybe some of it was. I would submit that part of it was about a feeling of disempowerment, a feeling that there are new moral norms being imposed from above without a chance for discussion or debate. In part, I think it's about a desire for agency. There's a similar force underlying the pushback against broad anti-discrimination laws that have been interpreted to require bakeries, florists, and other providers to offer their services for same-sex weddings, for example, or pharmacists who have devoted their careers to what they believe to be a public service driven by their moral convictions, but now forced by law to dispense products that they consider to be abortifacients, regardless of whether the product is available on any kind of widespread basis from other pharmacies in town. Or take the Black Lives Matter movement, which is not just about clearing the ground to make it easier to navigate bureaucracy on technical matters. It implicates bigger questions. What are the shared moral commitments that animate our legal system? When protesters demand that we stop using grand juries in cases of police shootings, it's a challenge to a core premise of our legal system, that our fellow citizens are colorblind and will be a reliably fair and impartial arbiter of justice. They are rejecting our society's use of a moral aspiration as a legal norm. Such use, they would claim, is itself immoral because it disregards reality and becomes an easy and superficially laudable distraction from racial injustice. They are asking for a single politically accountable actor to make charging decisions in cases of police shootings, rather than an unaccountable larger group of anonymous citizens. Can such a claim find traction in America today, or is it threatening to the presumptions underlying our commitment to the rule of law? In some respect, Black Lives Matter is a cry for moral agency. Much of the establishment's reaction to both Black Lives Matter and what I'll call the wedding cake dissenters undervalue the importance of moral agency to people's lives. To Black Lives Matter protesters, we say, your demands are inconsistent with the rule of law. You are rejecting at a wholesale level our system's capacity to deliver justice. You're feeding conspiracy theories and diminishing trust in our legal system through sweeping accusations about law enforcement, systemic racism, and/or intentional acts to subvert and oppress communities of color. To the wedding cake dissenters, we say, you're ignoring the lessons of the Jim Crow South. Your refusal to bake a cake for the same-sex wedding denies the human dignity of your fellow citizens, even if another bakery in town could provide the service. Once you decide to open your business to the public, you must abide by public norms, and those norms include a commitment not to discriminate. Discrimination is wrong, period, and you are not welcome in our commercial sphere unless and until you agree to abide. These examples may take us into uncomfortable waters. The desire for greater human agency in the throes of the administrative state doesn't mean we have to license discrimination, does it? It doesn't mean we have to jettison the central role of our fellow citizens in a fair criminal justice system, does it? Well, not necessarily, but I think it means we have to be attentive to how the imposition of contested moral norms as legal norms impact human agency, regardless of our sympathy for the substance of those norms. Now, to be clear, our legal system can't avoid imposing contested moral claims in every respect. That's what the law does. That's what it's there for. I'm just urging a bit more caution and discernment. But caution and discernment surrounding legal norms is only one step toward enhancing moral agency. Providing more legal room to maneuver is helpful only if we as a society can cultivate a more outward-looking, other-centered moral engagement and discourse. Empathy is essential to moral deliberation. Some would go so far as to say it's constitutive of moral deliberation. If we value moral agency, we must value the social conditions conducive to the cultivation of empathy. I don't think it is too far afield to say we face an empathy deficit in our society. Our technology-fueled separation and segmentation is intensely problematic for many reasons, including for moral agency. Our reactions to Black Lives Matter and the wedding cake dissenters can function as Rorschach tests for an overarching moral worldview. The largest newspaper in Minnesota, progressive, left-leaning Minnesota, did a survey earlier this year on the heels of some very disruptive protests and found that 94% of white Minnesotans have a negative view of Black Lives Matter, and 94% of black Minnesotans have a positive view of Black Lives Matter. That is a failure of empathy. A key resource for our pursuit of empathy, I think, is the concept of civil friendship. The notion that citizens should seek out and build relationships with one another founded on solidarity, not agreement. We need legal space to engage in moral deliberation and collaboration, but we need to utilize that space by getting outside ourselves. Here's where this election might help. We now know, I hope, that we have to reach out to those with whom we disagree. We cannot rely on easy affinity or assumed mutual understanding. We have to work at civil friendship now more than ever. I think that's good for human agency in the political sphere. It also means we may need to refocus on local politics. Empathy is fed by relationship, which warrants shifting our gaze to the local, where political engagement and relationships go hand in hand. This is an insight from the principle of subsidiarity, which I'd be happy to talk about when I see the end of the day. I won't belabor it here. Many Americans have embraced the fiction that our primary path of political engagement is our choice of whom we support for president. That matters, of course, but that's a relatively small component of our common good. Aristotle defined the political community as a partnership of the citizens. The aims of the partnership, according to Aristotle, are virtue and happiness. Aristotle's vision is most viable at the local level. The local is important not primarily as a microcosm of a larger national struggle between worldviews, but as a path to relationship. It's where civil friendship can be most easily realized. The perceived moral agency deficits being expressed by Black Lives Matter and by wedding cake dissenters, while raising some questions of national policy, are both most fruitfully addressed locally in the context of real relationships. That's where face-to-face conversations and concrete ideas for collaboration can drive the outcomes. So 2 days ago in the Twin Cities, a county prosecutor rejected the use of a grand jury and filed charges against an officer who shot Philando Castile 7 times during a traffic stop last summer. The prosecutor, John Choi, explained at a press conference in detail the specific reasons why he concluded that this shooting lacked any justification. A member of the local black community attended the press conference and remarked to a reporter afterwards, quote, "To have that prosecutor give words to what we've been proclaiming, that's all we can ask for right now," unquote. That's not just about outcomes. It's about agency. A moral assertion made through protest, ultimately reflected in a decision made by a person vested with legal authority. Also earlier this week, the Washington State Supreme Court heard the case of a 71-year-old florist who had served a gay customer named Robb for years but declined to provide flowers for his wedding. She complained that the government was forcing her to choose, quote, between her affection for Robb and her faith, unquote. To critics, her interpretation of her faith's teaching on homosexuality rendered her affection for her gay customer incomplete and inauthentic. She insists that they are compatible, but that she needs the legal space to carve out a path that honors both. She is making a claim for moral agency. Red tape, bureaucracy, a lack of economic opportunity, those are not the only obstacles to human agency among the working class. If we care about human agency in an age of deep and broad moral pluralism, we have to do work on other fronts as well. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Phil, for having me, and thanks to everybody for coming. I want to frame my remarks around the 2016 political moment because, of course, none of us have heard enough about the 2016 election, so we may talk about it, might just talk about it a little bit more. But if you think about the twin messages of both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton on the one hand answering the problems of the low income and the working class Americans of our society with free college tuition, with increased minimum wages, and Donald Trump on the other hand answering those questions and those concerns with protectionism, with lower immigration, build the wall so that those Mexicans don't take all of our jobs. The meta-narrative, I think, that runs through both of those messages is that moral agency actually doesn't matter that much. It's the idea that the fundamental political challenges that face our country are how can someone else solve your problems, not how can you solve your own problems. Now, that doesn't mean, of course, that there are things policymakers can't do to make life easier for lower-income Americans, but we've become a country that's very, very bad at striking the balance between recognizing the real barriers that occasionally exist in the lives of our working class and lower-income Americans, but also recognizing that they still have some control over their own choices. And I think that failure to recognize the importance of moral agency is incredibly self-destructive in communities like mine, communities that I wrote about in my book. And so I want to discuss that along three separate dimensions, and then I'll stop talking. So the first dimension is something that education reformers, if there are any in the room, may recognize, this idea of a Gollum effect. And the basic idea is that children who perceive that they are less intelligent, that they are less capable, work less hard in school. It's relatively intuitive if you think about it. When I was in the first grade, I remember we had this exercise in the beginning of the morning where we would go around the class and answer a math problem that led to the number of the day. So if the number of the day was 30, you could start out and be easy. So 29 plus 1, 28 plus 2, and so forth. But I decided that I would try out subtraction that day. I gave an answer of 35 minus 5 to come up with a number of 30. And right after me, my friend Bill came up with the answer of 3 times 10. And I remember looking at him and thinking, who is this guy that knows multiplication already? Because I hadn't even heard what times was. And at the moment, I internalized, not that I hadn't been taught multiplication yet, I internalized that I was an idiot, that I was stupid, that Bill was smarter than me. And unfortunately, the culture that I lived in did not provide a countervailing message. So I remember, to give you an idea of what a different message would be, when I was sitting down with my then-girlfriend, now-wife's father, and we were talking about his incredibly accomplished daughters. And I told him that his one daughter, who graduated of Yale and Yale Law School, is going to clerk for the Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court next year, and his other daughter, an engineer from Duke who works at Raytheon, that he had raised two incredibly brilliant women. Because in my mind, accomplishment was inextricably linked to talent. And what he said to me, and I will never forget this, is they're not actually that smart. They just work very hard. And there was a clear distinction between him, a first-generation Indian immigrant, and me, a white working-class American from Southwest Ohio. I thought success was about ability, and he thought success was about hard work. Of course, it's about both, but I think recognizing that one culture is emphasizing one thing pretty successfully, and another culture is emphasizing something else quite unsuccessfully is important. The second context I want to talk about this is in addiction, which is very hard for me personally because, as I wrote about in the book, it's something that my family knew very well. Now, if you look at the recent genetics research, the recent neuroscience research, it's quite clear that there is a link between biology and predisposition towards addiction. So maybe some people's brains are hardwired in a certain way. Maybe they have a certain chemical imbalance that makes it easier for them to become addicted to alcohol or to drugs or even to food or sexual activity. We've heard a lot about sexual addiction in the past couple of years. But what's really fascinating about the addiction research that I've seen is that while it's important to recognize, of course, that addiction fundamentally is at least partially a biological problem, when people recognize that their addiction is biological, when they say things like, "Don't judge me for my addiction, it's a disease, you wouldn't judge a cancer patient for having a tumor," those folks are actually less likely to fight their addiction. They show less success in overcoming the consequences of their addiction. Now again, this doesn't mean that we should ignore the fact that there are complex causes to addiction. But if we can't also recognize, on the other hand, moral agency, the importance of actually choosing better decisions and better life choices, then we've sort of given up in some ways. We've sort of sacrificed something very important, one of the most important, maybe the most important tool that we have. And then the final thing, and this sort of intersects a little bit with a lot of Phillips' arguments about regulation, I'm going to talk about U.S. family policy. And I will preface this by saying that luckily these problems are going in a good direction. They certainly haven't gotten all the way there, but we're at least starting to recognize this very significant problem we have in family policy. And that's this, that when a kid who grows up in a traumatic or neglectful household enters the child welfare bureaucracy, they encounter a bureaucracy that fundamentally has a predisposition towards one outcome. And that outcome is, if the situation is severe enough, removal from the child from their nuclear family and placement typically in a licensed foster care family. Now that's one option if you think about a kid who has a traumatic circumstance and has to have some way out of their family life. So another option, of course, is that we could just leave the kid with their abusive or neglectful parent. That doesn't seem like a very good option. But there's a third option that some states, like I said, have increasingly tried that tends to show the best outcomes for kids who are the victims of abuse and neglect. And that's instead of placing them with a licensed foster care parent or leaving them in the home of the nuclear family, they place them in what's called kinship care, so with an aunt or an uncle or a grandmother. Now, what's fascinating about this is that even though the evidence is clear that placement in a kinship care situation is better for the outcome of kids, most states still require some sort of, or at least erect some sort of regulatory barrier towards these kinship care placements. So one is a licensing requirement, requiring that any person who takes care of an abused or neglected kid has to be licensed by the state. Another is that abused or neglected kids can't go with their grandparents because the grandparents are not eligible for any sort of state support. So the foster care parent is eligible for the support, but the grandparents are. And so what this effectively does is take a piece of civil society and regulate it away. It erects a very real barrier to one of the most important social safety nets that exists in our society, the family network that we have outside of our mom and dad. Again, I think this comes down to moral agency. You create, or at least in this case, actually eliminate a space where grandparents and aunts and uncles can act morally in their children's lives. So that these three separate cases that I mentioned, and I'm sure there are many, many others, illustrate something that we've seen in our politics, which is that we are increasingly a society that doesn't respect, doesn't even talk about human agency. To even discuss human agency, even in the way that I've discussed it, sometimes invites criticisms that you're blaming the victim. But you don't need to blame the victim to recognize that sometimes the victim still has some control over their life. Indeed, I think that it's something much more insulting to people to suggest that just because they weren't born with as much fortune as we have, that they don't have agency, that they don't have anything in their lives that they can control. I think it's very self-destructive. And the last thing that I'll say is that this is not a problem that makes for easy policy solutions. It would be the most ironic piece of legislation in the world that tried to legislate moral agency back into people's lives. But I do think that whether it's the foster care and kinship care example that I mentioned earlier, I know Philip has a lot of other ideas, there are opportunities to use policy to reinvigorate civil society, to reinvigorate the spaces in our shared society where people can exercise agency and do it hopefully well. So I think that's a real, or should be a real goal for policymakers. And because we're not having these conversations these days, I think it should be a real goal for thought leaders to talk more about the importance of individual choice and individual agency. Because without it, I think ultimately you leave kids who grow up like I did feeling that they have no control over their lives. And I can't imagine anything that's more self-destructive. So with that, I'll shut up. Thank you.
Thank you. I enjoyed reading your book. I don't have the resources to go visit 29 communities and probably don't have the personality to be welcomed into those places in any case. So it gave me a sense of what it would be like to live in a certain culture. And I can testify that not only is it a New York Times bestseller, but two people came up to me on the subway as I was reading it and said that they too have read it. So it's number one on the F train, according to my informal study. You know, we saw this morning, even in Gilfie's most pessimistic charts that showed secular decline, a pickup in the last 5 years. Matt Winkler showed us at lunch that at a macro economy, things are not that bad, particularly during the last administration. And I was actually very interested to learn today that the decline in labor force participation can be explained by demographics and an increase in schooling of young people. I didn't know that, and I appreciate knowing that. And if we look at Middletown, Ohio, it tells the same story. So you see, Philip, I have prepared for this. The unemployment in Middletown and Cincinnati, because they're grouped together, is 4.3%. Ohio as a whole is 4.8%. And Middletown is down from 11.1% in January of 2011. The highest unemployment in all of Ohio is in Youngstown, is 6.2%. And that's down from, I think, 16% in 2010 and 20% in 1994. So, you know, if it was just finding jobs, you would see signs in people's yards in Middletown saying, hooray for the status quo, or how about the, hey, elite, keep up the good work. But I haven't been there, but that doesn't seem to be the sentiment. So
I haven't seen that sign.
You have not. No, I felt that was a safe bet. And you know, it's not inequality in any measurable way. If you look at the monthly income last month for the top 10% divided by the top bottom 10 percentile in Philadelphia, Detroit, Chicago, Miami, LA, it's five times. It's six times in San Francisco and Boston and New York, and seven times in DC. In Middletown, Ohio, it's 3.9 times. So, I mean, it's just one statistic, but it certainly points to the fact that it's not income inequality that's the problem. And wages are $22 an hour, which is, It have been stagnant, but basically in keeping with national averages. You know, maybe it's something like, if it is economics, maybe, you know, people were afraid in 2009 and they didn't want to rebel with their vote, and now they feel safe to rebel. I don't know. I'm not a psychiatrist, but you know, well, I don't know what it is, and maybe JD and Philip and Kathy, who studied these things more closely, will have a better insight. But from the perspective of an economist, I think I'd like to suggest one thing that may keep us from seeing what what's eating the working class might be. you know, Adam Smith said the purpose of production is consumption, and that underlies the neoclassical view of the labor market. We sometimes talk on the fringes about other things, but the basic idea, we give up a certain amount of our tranquility and leisure time. Some jobs are clearly more pleasant and will accept a lower wage. Some are more challenging, and all the other features that a job can have. That's all well understood and old news. But the diagnosis seems to be about something else. And I've seen four things today that I find convincing. One that we've talked about before in the center for a long time that I know I fervently believe to be important are the a lack of dynamism, which is stimulated in turn by values which have no other explanation, and the research showing that it derives from a change in values about commercial life is very persuasive to me. I also find the notion of fissure to be something I also found compelling, as people are, if I can use the word alienation in this setting, feeling alienated from their work and their production, in addition with franchises and maybe oppression about the time that time frames that people need to operate under. I think all of those seem to me to have a good deal of merit, and I find it very hard to see how one might shoehorn that into a neoclassical model. So, you know, maybe accepting that there's a realm of concern that are, as economists, that we can understand clearly and have a lot to say about, but that maybe there are other values that stand aside. Even, you know, if we take trade as an example, you know, the intuition that seems to be shared by both parties that somehow free trade is working against the interests of working people. Is it just confusion that they don't understand about the vintner and the cloth maker in Portugal and the same one in England, and that it would be better off if England would send cloth to Portugal and Portugal would send wine to India, as has been known for 200 years? Are they mistaken? Can they not understand it? Are they confused about it? Or maybe there's something else. Maybe there's some idea that the kind of life that was provided by AK Steel in Middletown, Ohio is gone, and this is the impulse that they have to try to bring that back. I don't know. You don't have to call security on me. I'm not saying we should have trade barriers and losing free trade. But I think that taking these ideas seriously is something that we as economists ought to have the tools to be able to do, by recognizing limits of neoclassical model, which are more than just being confused by biases or behavioral heuristics, but something more fundamental than that. Okay, now, I know that as Philip points out, I'm standing between us and the bar, and in a day where the session on why we should be hopeful included an observation that a lunatic may engineer smallpox and spread it with a drone, we may all want to go as quickly as we can to get a drink. So I'll turn things back over to Philip to sum up.
My first job was I was 18 and I was plucked out of I was working in a poverty program and I was plucked out of the grounds crew before I ever mowed any grass at the Oak Ridge National Lab, and became the gopher to a Nobel Prize winner called Eugene Wigner. It was great. I ended up publishing. It was just fantastic. I mean, it was like the luckiest thing in my life. One of my first projects was to figure out how many people I could kill using not a drone but a Cessna airplane and certain biological agents. And it's actually quite a going to that sort of the gloom and groom story. It's quite a terrifying result from doing that. But trying to turn toward hope, I actually think the inverse of what we're talking about, of the lack of values and all that stuff, is actually an incredible flourishing if we could come to terms with a new framework for the social contract. And so I'm going to throw out a quick hypothesis to everybody on the panel, particularly JD. I was really struck by the licensing the grandparents, for God's sake. I mean, oh my God, it's so stupid. And the whole wedding cake thing, it's just so over the top to me. So one hypothesis is that we turn at least many areas, not pollution, from one of regulation or prescription to oversight. The traditional role of law was actually to set outer boundaries. You know, you can do it in freedom. You're free to do whatever you want as long as you don't cheat people, break your contracts, run the red lights, all that kind of stuff. Law is a concept of boundaries. And that's why it protects free society. This kind of modern idea of law is that it reaches inside the field and tells everybody what to do, and it drives people nuts. So you could imagine, and they sort of do this in Utah now with child welfare, but moving towards a much more judgment-based, okay, we're going to try this and see how it works idea. That's one concept. And I think you could do the same thing with morality. We could make state choices. And one of the state choices could be, it's not okay to discriminate on the basis of race in matters of public accommodation. That's just a value. We're not going to let people do that because we have a terrible history as a society. We're just not going to let people do that. On the other hand, if there are places in our society where people genuinely disagree as a matter of religious or other conviction, we will actually let people make choices and not sell birthday, as long as they're available. There are other pharmacies, other bakeries and stuff. So one could imagine actually accepting moral diversity and incorporating that within a framework, the same way we, in a free society, incorporate all kinds of behavior, you know, within legal boundaries, that including, you know, immoral behavior of a variety of sorts is not, it's not illegal. So just shooting that over, is there something there?
Yeah, so just as one example, I'm all in favor of the state having a conversation, what are the goods and services that we deem essential to full participation in our society? Housing, employment, whatever the list is, I'm agnostic on that for these purposes. And then, what intervention is necessary to ensure access to those goods and services? So, for example, when the pharmacist wars erupted in Illinois, it erupted from a customer who went in, I believe, to a Walgreens in the Loop and was denied a particular product she had a valid prescription for because of the pharmacist's moral convictions. There was an Osco drug directly across the street in the Loop where she could have gotten it. The state, though, intervened on her behalf as a matter of dignity. There should not be an affront to dignity regardless of access. And one thing I would say in terms of the moral framework we are comfortable with as the premise for legal intervention is affronts to dignity cannot always be avoided through the imposition of legal norms in a pluralist society that we have today.
Yeah, so one thought that I have is just, there's this question about obviously how to enforce the outer boundaries, and this strikes me as where the administrative state and the regulatory state are in, you know, some conflict with some of the ideas that you care most about. And the sort of Burkean conservative in me wonders, as someone who isn't an expert on the regulatory state, why is this the way that our society developed to regulate some of these outer boundaries, and then obviously through interstitial rulemaking to sort of regulate something much more confined than these outer boundaries? Because it strikes me that if we want to have the sorts of society where there's a little bit more freedom to operate, where you're setting the rules and then letting people operate within it, it's very hard to imagine that society coexisting with the current administrative state. But then, like I said, I get a little bit worried about, does that mean you blow up the administrative state, or do you kick everything back to sort of civil law? I just don't know.
Yeah. There is a cultural problem I was talking about with Alan about in Washington. you don't blow up the goals of the state, but you do, I think, have to go to a human responsibility results-oriented model, where in my world, officials, the child agency people, actually are allowed to exercise their judgment about whether the grandparents are doing a good job or not. Because unless you give them the authority that goes along with that responsibility, they're going to instead create this licensing system that's this rigid system. And if you go through every, so a simple, not entirely accurate, but mainly accurate answer to why do we have this state we have, it's because we're unwilling to give anybody in the state any authority to make a judgment and be accountable for it to the people around them. And that was a conservative credo just as much as it was a liberal credo. So one place they come together. No one can be free to make a judgment. And I think that premise, which we talked about earlier in the day, that premise is one that always leads to the denial of human agency on the ground, because in an interdependent society, freedom and authority are synonyms, and they are concentric. If the teacher is not, or the principal or the teacher is not, doesn't have the authority to act on the parent's ideas, then the parent doesn't have the dignity of being able to go and argue this is a bad way of running the school or running the class or whatever. And so if you don't have that up the chain of authority, it ripples back down and you get this system that we have today.
So one just additional random thought on this point of sort of the regulatory state and agency. So my day job is I'm a technology investor and we have a number of biotechnology companies. And one of the things that I'm always struck by in this conversation about, why are your interactions with the FDA so negative? Why is this, they universally feel, whatever their place on the political spectrum, that the FDA is remarkably intransigent in a way that does not promote human health. And the answer that they always give is that you don't want to be the regulator who lets through a drug that kills somebody. And I think that's very relevant to this question of whether you're willing to take moral agency over some of these decisions.
Yeah, completely. I was on a committee that McKinsey put together a few years ago on that very point. How do we make drug approval agency take responsibility? And the answer is you only get in trouble, and that's one of the problems of the culture of Washington, with making decisions. You never get in trouble for saying no, or almost never. So you do have to create actually a form of cover, one way or another. I mean, we can talk about it later, but I think there are ideas. But it's a serious problem in a government agency where in an interdependent society things go wrong. If you let the kids go outside and play, there will be accidents and kids will break their legs, and every once in a while a kid will die. Does that mean that you shouldn't let kids go out and play? Everybody who's an expert in child development says it's just crazy what we're doing to the children in this country. But no one will take the risk. So somehow we need to come up, and it's not just legal protection at this point, it's also cultural and political protection. Why don't we have we have some interesting people, have a few questions here, and then if I see you staggering out really shaky, I'll know that I just had to go get the drink. Can you identify yourself? Do you want a microphone? Here we go. I have a microphone.
Okay. As I see it, we've had a fabulous day starting with conversation about innovation and how.
My mic doesn't work because somebody, it's just conspiracy against the.
We've had a great day in which we started talking about innovation and how innovation might be driving down some prices of the things that the innovation is producing, the new kinds of innovation of recent decades. And that led to the possibility that innovation is also driving down wage rates and extinguishing what used to be good jobs. And now we have the rare good fortune to have in this panel two people from Appalachia or nearby anyway.
We can talk that way too.
So I'd love to hear from you what you think about agency down there, what you think could be done to increase agency of the people who are down and out and stuck in bad jobs and don't feel they have room to do anything. Is there anything that what do you think the government might do, or what might society do in some other ways? And also, what about self-help? Is there some chance that they might all go to California and be happy ever after, or is that not in the cards? And if not, why not?
Yeah, so as somebody who worries quite a bit about the economic dislocation of Appalachia and surrounding regions, one of the reactions I often met with, including from my own mind, is it's not like this is the first time that we've had regionally focused periods of economic dislocation and disruption, right? And so the question is always, is it different this time? Are we effectively just seeing the same problems that folks have been worried about in these various periods of very rapid change in the history of our country, or is something different? And the one thing I'll say is that I do think there are a couple of things that maybe are different about this particular period of disruption, and that's that we're living in a world with, I think, less economic and especially less geographic mobility than we've had in the past in the country. So it doesn't so much bother me that we have disruptive regional economies and so forth. It does worry me a little bit that folks are not moving quite as much as they used to, not just in between socioeconomic classes, but more importantly, within geographic areas of the country. So that's one thing that worries me about it. And so if there's a policy response, I'm a pretty big fan of some of the work that suggests that we may benefit as a society from things like geographic mobility vouchers, which encourage people to move from areas of low employment to high employment. There are, of course, cultural disruptions that come along with that, so I'm always a little bit worried about the downsides, but the sense that I get is that if we promoted greater mobility in the country, it would probably be a net benefit.
Yeah, let me just say, Appalachia, my father tried to do economic things when he was there as a preacher. I have good friends who still live in Whitesburg, Kentucky, about a population 1,300. It was 1,300 in 1958, it was 1,300 now. The only opportunity for flourishing there is through ownership of community services through capital provided by the government. There is no economic hope for that region. There's no resource, no agricultural resource. It's hills without valleys. Hollers, there's no, the floods come in, it's just not a place where people really should live or settle. I mean, so they should move, and if they can't move, at least they ought to have the dignity of owning and taking care of, having more to say in the social services for the people who remain. Yes? And Ned, you can just go like this whenever you're ready to cut off. There are a bunch of hands.
So I think in the earlier panel, everyone agreed that this hollowing out of the middle class in the Rust Belt has been going on for 20, 30, maybe 40 years. So my question is, why won't you consider emigration? So just to lay it out, during the time of the British Empire, middle class British men would go over to India and take jobs to build their careers in the Indian civil service, railways, military, and so on. So that provided a channel for absorbing, employment needs. Whereas, just think about it, last 8 years, the economy has been, now it's doing okay with jobs, but not eight years, economy has been struggling to create jobs. And if 2 or 3 million could have gone over in this time to the fast-growing economies in China or India, then that provides such a big relief. It would have provided such a big relief. And then basically all the Midwestern towns, all these factory towns, auto, steel, the jobs actually moved to China. And So if you follow the immigration pattern, if you went where the jobs are, then not everybody, but just 2 or 3 million, and it's easy for the emerging economies because they have such a huge population. They're creating 10 million new jobs every year. So if they could absorb this, then might we have seen a different history. And today I'm a little bit scared with what I hear from the afternoon panels that they want more collective action, like as a solution to the current problem, and they still won't consider immigration at all. And so my worry is why won't anyone consider immigration? Is it because of the welfare state was too strong? It promised them lifelong income security in these areas that they'd never ever thought of leaving, and they thought somehow or the other either the community or the state will give them.
Well, no, I'm not an expert on this, but just from the talk this morning, I'm guessing it has something to do with the fact that among the working class, your status, your station in life is so deeply personal to you that it's assumed that it has something to do with your own failure rather than extrinsic systemic forces, right? And so.
Richard Robb's family is moving to China.
My children have both emigrated. They did emigrate, but they didn't come from the Rust Belt looking for jobs in the steel mill, so I'm not sure they address your question.
Yeah, I mean, so my fear is that the idea of sort of shipping, you know, you could imagine a campaign slogan, ship the Scots-Irish back to Scotland. my worry is that, you know, it maybe works in a world where everyone is a perfectly rational economic actor. It strikes me as very culturally difficult to imagine shipping a bunch of Eastern Kentuckians to Mexico, for example. So I wonder whether whether mass migration across nationalities made a lot more sense when the world was less densely populated and you didn't have some of the cultural interactions that necessarily come with, let's say, sending 3 million white working class Americans to India.
Okay, one more question, yes.
I'd just like to, I've got a big voice, maybe I can make it happen.
Well, you're Canadian, right?
I'm a Canadian, yeah, so. Wondering how this panel thinks about situations where there's agency on both sides. Like, one of the examples, and again from Ohio, is the image of the Cleveland Indians. And there's a lot in the press right at the moment about the Cleveland Indians and the racist logo of the Cleveland Indians holding down the image, the self-image of folk that are indigenous to this continent. And so how do you think about that? I mean, obviously it's, hey, we don't want to be politically correct all the time. And on the other hand, we don't want to tell the Cleveland team what they need to do. But on the other hand, we want to encourage agency in the indigenous population.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a clash of agencies. It certainly, it does impact the agency of the couple that goes into the bakery and wants that bakery to provide for their wedding ceremony. What I would say is trying to accommodate maximum amounts of agency rather than perfect agency. So that's why I tend to focus on access. Yes, the couple should have some choice in terms of trying to structure their own lives, but you're never going to have perfect agency, because if your agency is empowered to completely overcome the agency of the, whether it's providers or whether it's the county prosecutor or whatever it is, it can't be an all or nothing game. You've got to try to accommodate both in some meaningful way. And I think access does that more than anything.
And also, to a certain extent, deal with it. Jonathan Haidt, who spoke at this conference last, H-A-I-D-T, spoke at this conference last year, has written a lot about the related issues of, you know, how offensive are you allowed to be, and what does it mean to live in a free society, and all that. It's all these questions. The waters are roiling. Thank you all.
Thank you.